You're surrounded by darkness, floating through the air. Suddenly, a bright light approaches. You enter a great hall and are greeted by the Hindu god of death, Yama, who rests beside his ferocious hellhounds, doted on by servants. His accountant, Chitragupta, is there, flipping through a book to check your karma, before realizing that, whoops, they messed up. There's been a mistake, and now they have to send you back. So you wake up in a hospital bed, surrounded by doctors, and very confused. The Hindus were right all along? What the hell just happened? You've just had a near-death experience. But does this mean that there's a heaven or a hell? At first glance, near-death experiences seem to be convincing proof of an afterlife. Except for a couple major problems. First off, in the largest study of NDEs ever conducted, only 9% of cardiac arrest survivors who were able to complete a detailed interview had a near-death experience. If everyone has souls, and everyone who dies goes to heaven or hell, then what's up with the other 91% who flatline but never have an NDE? But even with such a small percentage, there are still thousands of anecdotes from people who claim to have returned from the other side. In his 1975 book, Life After Life, Raymond Moody interviewed 150 people about their near-death experiences, and Dr. Jeffrey Long has accumulated over 4,000 near-death experience accounts online. Both are convinced that these stories are proof of an afterlife. But in both cases, they're all just anecdotes. I'm not saying that these people didn't experience something odd, but I am saying that we should take it with a grain of salt. Because if anecdotes meet your standard for what qualifies as evidence, then you should probably start buying tinfoil and food buckets, because there are just as many people who report seeing reptilians or who've been abducted by aliens. To prove just how useless anecdotes are, I successfully submitted a fictitious near-death experience to Dr. Long's website that's been up for over 2 weeks now, in which my leg was amputated and my heart stopped. I floated off the operating table before explosive diarrhea launched me at light speed to a beautiful rainforest paradise, where I was greeted by my dead grandpa and the golden robot god C-3PO, who was floating through the air on a chair and speaking in Spanish. You would expect that if any particular religious account of the afterlife were true, every NDE would be pretty much the same, but these accounts are so varied and are all based on cultural exposure. In India, people see Hindu gods. In Saudi Arabia, it's Muhammad, Allah, and a bunch of virgins. The kid from the book/movie Heaven is for Real saw a Jesus with bright blue eyes, and one little girl who went to heaven was greeted by a portly man with a white beard and a red cap, aka Santa Claus. But what about veridical NDEs? Near-death experiences in which the person sees something that they couldn't possibly otherwise have known while flatlining, and others are able to verify that what they saw is indeed correct. The most notorious example of this is Maria's shoe. A lady named Maria reportedly left her body, floated around, and saw a shoe on a ledge outside her hospital window that she couldn't possibly have seen. Her critical care provider, Kimberly Clark, looked outside and saw the shoe just as described, but when researchers tried to track down Maria to confirm Clark's story, they weren't able to find any such person or anyone else to corroborate the account. And when they placed a shoe on the ledge, it was clearly visible from the hospital room, proving Clark had exaggerated at least part of the story. In another case, according to spiritual healing advocate Larry Dossey, a woman named Sarah, who was blind from birth, had an NDE in which she saw scribbles on the whiteboard in the emergency room, and that her anesthesiologist was wearing mismatching socks. But when investigators pressed Dossey for more details, he later admitted it was a total fabrication. Not one case of veridical NDEs has ever been confirmed under a scientifically controlled setting. To quote physicist Dr. Vic Stinger, to scientifically prove life after death is going to require carefully controlled experiments, not just a lot of stories. The plural for anecdote is not data. Some people report gaining supernatural powers after an NDE. The great thing about this is we can test it. But no one has ever proven it under a controlled setting. Although, I hear the James Randi Foundation has been offering a $1 million prize to anyone who can prove that they have supernatural powers. One example of post-NDE supernatural claims is Danian Brinkley, who wrote a book in 1994 called Saved by the Light, in which he described his prophetic powers and claimed to have prophesied about things in 1975 that later came true. One of Danian's 1975 prophecies was that China would invade the Soviet Union, fight over a railroad, and proceed to march deep into the heart of the USSR. Yep. Totally happened. Oh, and Alex Malarkey, the kid from the book The Boy Who Came Back from Heaven, admitted that the entire story was a hoax after the book sold 1 million copies. While parapsychologists, pastors, and religious gurus are all quick to speculate and jump to conflicting conclusions that near-death experiences are proof of their god, scientists have consistently stated for decades now that we don't know exactly what's going on during an NDE, but they continue to do research, and here's what we found. There is no indication whatsoever that anything supernatural is going on. Dr. Sam Parnia took 4 years to conduct a study of 2,060 cardiac arrest patients. Of the 330 who survived, 140 were able to be interviewed, and only 9 had a near-death experience. 9 people is an absolutely tiny sample size by any stretch of the imagination, but in this and several other studies, cards bearing numbers and images were placed just above the bed, but out of sight of the doctors and patients, so that if the patients had had an out-of-body experience, or OBE, they would have seen the images. While many of the patients in these studies described having an out-of-body experience and floating above the operating table, not one in any of these studies described seeing the cards. But it gets even better. Every aspect of near-death experiences can be artificially induced in a lab. When the brain experiences hypoxia, or a decrease in oxygen, as happens to jet fighter pilots and centrifuges, feelings of euphoria, tunnel vision, hypervividness, clarity, and hallucinations can result. You can eliminate the tunnel vision experience by placing goggles on them that apply pressure to their eyes, counteracting the depressurizing effects of hypoxia on the eyes. Drugs such as ketamine, which interact with your NMDA receptors, can induce NDE-like experiences. This is relevant because your brain contains naturally occurring neuroprotective agents that bind to the same receptors and could potentially create these experiences naturally. There's growing evidence that the temporal lobe plays a huge role in creating NDEs. When patients had their brain scanned after an NDE, it was discovered that they had increased levels of temporal lobe activity compared with those in a control group. That could help explain why only a small percentage of people who flatline have NDEs. When Dr. Olaf Blanke implanted electrodes into the brains of patients, he was able to trigger supernatural and out-of-body experiences by stimulating the temporal parietal junction. To take this a step further, Dr. Michael Persinger created what he calls the God Helmet.
The experiences these people have had are clearly very real. The question is, do they represent something out in the world or inside the brain? Here at Laurentian University in Sudbury, Canada, people are having these strange experiences every day. The difference, scientists are triggering them with, of all things, magnets.
Over 1,000 people have worn it, and over 80% have had artificially induced supernatural or out-of-body experiences.
Where it gets really strange is Persinger is trying to incorporate the God Helmet into virtual reality technologies, possibly inside of a game.
Once supernatural experiences can be packaged up and commercialized, will people finally start to realize that it's all in their heads? Or are they going to start worshiping the god plumber Mario? Finally, a near-death experience does not mean that the person died. It means that they came close. In fact, it's a common misconception that a flat EEG indicates complete and total brain death. An EEG only measures electrical activity on the outer layers of the brain, not activity deep inside. Our brains do weird things, like hallucinate and have odd dreams. I'm not saying an NDE is the same as a dream, but both are arbitrary, unpredictable, and only occur a small percentage of the time, and neither one is proof of anything other than that our brains work in strange ways. Hell, if near-death experiences are evidence of Lord Shiva, then dreams are evidence that I'm a Super Saiyan, a Time Lord, and Batman. If near-death experiences were evidence of life after death, the evidence would be undeniable and all around us. 100% of the people who flatline would have NDEs and would return with the same vision of heaven. They would know things that they couldn't possibly otherwise know, and we'd have a lot more than just anecdotes. Instead, only a fraction of the people who are resuscitated have NDEs, their experiences are cultural and all over the place, and the feelings that they experience are replicable in the lab by messing with very specific brain regions. We have no evidence that NDEs are proof of life after death, evidence that should be there if that was indeed the case. Now, I know some of you are bummed by this, hoping for some type of eternal life after death. If that's the case, check out my video, Why is Heaven Bad? But disregarding wishful thinking, there's still a bright side. If this life is all there is, then there's no hell afterwards. If there's no hell, then there's no demons. And if there's no afterlife, then there's no angry spirits or ghosts lingering on long after they're dead, haunting houses and old buildings. That's a good thing. Because that's one less thing that you have to be afraid of. These experiences aren't meaningless. They show us the value and brevity of life. Life is short, which is what makes it so precious. You don't have to live a life in fear of hell. But do live it with fervor, love, and curiosity, because it's probably all you've got. And that's okay, because while we're here, we've got each other. Massive thank you to all of my incredible patrons. You guys are what make this show possible. I couldn't do it without you. If you want to support the show and get some cool perks in the process, head to patreon.com/holykoolaid, or you can donate through PayPal or Bitcoin. Make the most of this short but oh so beautiful life, and don't drink the Kool-Aid.